Welcome to our fourth class in the letters of Paul, or the Pauline epistles, as they're sometimes called. When I listed the Pauline epistles as being the title for this class, I had people coming up to me and says, what does Pauline mean? Well, I said, letters written by Paul are Pauline the same way that buildings built by Rome are Roman. Okay, it's the adjectival form of it. Anyway, the letters of Paul. Today we're going to look at Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. Now those aren't in order, but we're doing that because Philemon, very short letter, is one of the four prison epistles. Last week we looked at Ephesians. Ephesians is the first of the prison epistles, as they're called. And then Philippians, Colossians, Philemon, all four of those letters are believed to have been written when Paul was in prison. They're called the prison epistles. And so it made more sense to put Philemon here than anywhere else, so we'll talk about that. Let's start out with a word of prayer. Let's pray together. Father God, we are truly grateful again for your grace. Thank you for a night of rest and for the opportunity to once again open your word to study the things that you have taught us through your servant Paul, through the experiences he had and the letters that he wrote for us. We pray that your Holy Spirit would guide us, teach us. Let us learn more of you and grow closer to you as we study the words of your servant Paul. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Of course, last week Galatians and Ephesians, this week Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. If you've missed any of the classes, you know you can get them online at litchapala.org. Next week we will look at 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, they're all wonderful little books, but 1st and Thessalonians are very interesting, partly because the church at Thessalonica, someone had come along after Paul was there and planted the church and convinced them that the Lord had already come back, and they missed it. So that's one of the major themes in the letters to the church of Thessalonica. We'll look at next week. Then week six, we'll talk about the pastoral epistles. Those are the letters that Paul wrote to people who had been his assistants, people he had mentored, that is Timothy and Titus, who then later themselves became pastors. Actually, Timothy eventually became the bishop of Ephesus. Titus became the bishop on the island of Crete. And so these three letters called the pastoral epistles. Paul is writing to people that had learned from him and that had studied under him and traveled with him, giving them instructions on how to be a pastor. And then week seven, we will spend the first hour talking about the significance of Paul. We'll talk about some of the major theological themes that we can draw out of all of Paul's writing. And the second half, of course, the final exam. If the good Lord's willing and the stakes don't rise, next week I will have for you the document, everything you need to know from the class of the letters of Paul, that you can begin to study for the final exam. Do plan on taking that exam, even if you're not taking this for credit, because if you study for it and take that test, you will learn more from the course, I promise you. And it is not hard. If you're new to these classes, don't panic about taking a test. I will tell you everything you need to know. Is that not true?
True. Those
of you
who've
done it. Okay, that's good. These images from Paul. One of the reasons I always put up these images of Paul is because even though they're not photographs, of course they couldn't be, we do want to have a sense, always remember that this was a real person, that Paul was a real individual, and there's a very consistent understanding of what he looked like, even though there were no photographs, because most of the early churches, again, these pictures, the one on the left is from the Church of St. Clara in Istanbul. The one on the bottom right is from Philippi, actually, the Chapel of Lydia in Philippi. We're going to be talking about Philippians today. And the one above that is from Patmos, from the Monastery of St. John. But the images we have of Paul, likewise with Peter and some of the others, are really quite consistent. And that's an affirmation to me, people who knew what he looked like. So we'll be able to recognize him when we see him again. These letters, this chart in the overheads will give you the letters of Paul in chronological order. We are not studying them in chronological order. They are not in the Bible in chronological order. They are in the Bible according to length. Romans is the longest, so it comes first. Philemon is the shortest, so it comes last. I don't know who thought that was a good idea. I've said that before. But previously, I have rearranged things in order to do them either chronologically or according in the Old Testament. According to the Old Testament Tanakh, the Hebrew Bible's approach to it, and people have just gotten confused. The next book of the Bible is not that, it's this. So I'm giving you this chart, which will tell you what order they were written in, as best we know, starting with Galatians through 2 Timothy being the last of the letters that Paul wrote, And we're right in the middle right now. We're, you know, we're Colossians, Philemon, Philippians, this is where we are. But this will give you information. This little chart's very useful because it tells you not only the order that they were written in and the approximate dates, but it also gives you who they were written to and the basic theme. So this is a useful little chart. And it's okay for you to go in and pull this up, print out that sheet if you want to use that for a study aid. We've looked at this map before. Of course, these are the major centers in Paul's life. Born in Tarsus, educated in Jerusalem, converted on the way to Damascus. He spent most of his ministry life in Antioch, but he visited all of these other places. Lastly, of course, to Rome. Today we're going to be talking about several of these. Philippi, which was the first congregation planted in Europe. This is Asia, what we know of as Turkey, and then, of course, Syria, Lebanon, Israel. Over here is what we know of as Greece. The dividing line right there, that's where Istanbul is. There's a thin body of water there called the Bosphorus. And Istanbul is the only city in the world that sits on two continents, because half of it's on the Asia side, half of it's on the Europe side. Well, that dividing line, Paul, when he first crossed over to Europe, after seeing a vision of a man from Macedonia, crossed over, and the first place he went that they planted a church was Philippi. We're going to look at Philippians today. He then traveled along, planted a church at Thessalonica. We'll look at those letters next week. And then down to Athens and Corinth, which we've already looked at. One of the other places that Paul wrote a letter to is Colossae, the town of Colossae, which had been a major city prior, 100 years prior to Paul. But by the time of Paul's writing, Colossae had declined in importance. It was overshadowed not only by Ephesus, which was quite a bit east of it, or west of it, but there are two other towns that are 12 and 14 miles from Colossae, the towns of Hierapolis and of Laodicea. And both Laodicea and Hierapolis had grown in importance and had overshadowed the town of Colossae. So it was not a major town by the time Paul was there. But that's where we're talking about. The book of Philippians written to the church in Philippi, the book of Colossians written to the church in Colossae, and the book of Philemon, which is written to an individual, one person, Philemon is his name. Philemon lived in Colossae. So those two cities are the focus of the things that we're studying today. As always, please stop me if you've got any questions. I think I've shown you this chart before. This is another one that might be useful. Looking at a list from AD 40 to AD 95, we have here when Paul's major events, the first missionary journey and when he went, the Jerusalem Council is recorded in Acts 15, the second missionary journey to Macedonia, Achaia, and Greece, that's when he crossed over, the third missionary journey to Asia, which means Asia Minor. Asia was a smaller province in the larger Asia Minor, which we know of as Turkey, etc. You know, his trials, the first Roman imprisonment, the fourth missionary journey, which not everybody agrees that Paul made a fourth missionary journey, but there's very strong traditional testimony that he ended up being released from Rome after being imprisoned there the first time, that he went to Spain, and then possibly went on to Britain. Now, I know I've told you that before. I've told you that about three times. But redundancy is very important in order for people to remember things. If you only hear something once, then you're going to forget it. So important things I'm going to mention more than once. You can count on it. And you'll hear that again, probably. And then the second Roman imprisonment and martyrdom in Rome. And then AD 70, the destruction of Jerusalem. And then here, they have the various books in chronological order. And you can then see approximately when they were written. We are here right now. Ephesians, Colossians, Philemon, and Philippians. We're looking at Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon today. Are three of the four prison letters. Ephesians we did last week. We believe they were written when Paul was in Rome, between 60 and 63, so they appear here on the timeline. The only books that were written later than these were 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus. Okay? We're going to circle back around and do Thessalonians next week. The letters to the Thessalonians, some people believe were written even before the letters to Galatians, so they were very early in his career as a writer and missionary. Okay? Questions about any of that? Paul's second missionary journey, AD 49 to 51, he went overland from Antioch. The first time he had gone by sea to Cyprus and then up to... by the way, I misspoke earlier. I said Titus was the bishop of Crete, I believe. He's the bishop of Cyprus. Paul left Antioch, went overland, revisited the churches of Galatia, Derbe, Lystra, Iconium, and then over to Troas, had a vision of a man of Macedonia, crossed over here, landed at Neapolis, which today is called Kavala, the town is still there on the coast, and then to Philippi. And so that's where the Philippian church was first planted. The first convert in Europe was a woman, Lydia, a seller of purple, which means that she, and she was not from Europe, she originally was from Asia Minor, but she was living there, and she and her household were converted. If you go to Philippi today, there is a chapel to Lydia, which is where that photograph of the mosaic I had taken. There is a very popular place there where traditionally Lydia was baptized, and it's now set up so that people get baptized there a lot. We had a communion service there when Carolyn and I visited. So Philippi became the first church planted in Europe, and it was a major trade center. And the reason is, as I told you, Byzantium, which later in the 300s gets renamed Constantinople because Constantine, the new emperor of everything, made that his capital. There was a major highway, the Via Ignatia, which runs right through here and then goes over there to Rome, somewhere over there. So this major town, or major highway rather, Via Ignatia, went right through Philippi. And so it was a major trade route. There was a lot of business, there was a lot of travel. It was a significant town. Anytime you were on a major Roman road, you would be a place where there was a lot of business done. And so Philippi was a significant city. Paul then revisited it on his third journey. Again, he went overland. This was the trip that he spent 2.5 to 3 years in Ephesus. He crossed over, went back up to Philippi. He actually crossed over, went down to Corinth, and then back up to Philippi. So he visited there twice. And then, interestingly enough, Colossae, which is shown right here, Paul apparently never visited Colossae. But one of the people that he knew very well and that he worked a lot with, Epaphras, there's two guys in these letters, Epaphroditus and Epaphras. Epaphras planted the church in Colossae, and because Epaphras had visited Paul in Ephesus, Ephesus wasn't that far away, and then there are all these other churches that were planted. These are all the locations of churches in here. Paul came to know Epaphras, came to understand about the church in Colossae, and so he ended up writing the letter. It's one of the few letters that he wrote to a place that he never did end up visiting. He wrote a letter to the church in Rome, the letter of Romans, before he went there, but he eventually did visit. We have no record that he ever made it to Colossae, unless when he was 2.5 years in Ephesus, he may have traveled over here and visited some of the churches, but we have no record of that. As far as we know, he never got there. Okay? So, twice Paul visited Philippi in his second and third journey. Let's talk about the book of Philippians. You will see common dates on all of these because as I said, we believe that these are three of the four letters Paul wrote when he was in prison in Rome. Now there's some disagreement with that. Some people believe that nobody doubts that he was in prison because he talks about being in chains for Christ. He talks about the believers in Caesar's household send your greeting. Well, those are indications and why most people believe that Paul wrote these. We know he was in prison. But there are markers in here that indicate that he was in Rome, which was the center of the Roman Empire, like when he says the members of Caesar's household. Apparently, some of the guards that were watching Paul were converted to the faith by his preaching. When he was in Rome for 2 years under house arrest, the indication was he was allowed to preach, but people had to come to him. He couldn't go out, but people would come to him, but they would come to him and he would preach. Indication is some of the guards, because he mentions guards that were converted elsewhere. And then Caesar's household might have indicated part of the royal court of the emperor. Anytime you've got a king or an emperor, you've got a court. So others have said, no, they don't think he was actually writing this from Rome. They think he was in either when he was imprisoned in Caesarea, when he first got arrested in Jerusalem, he was taken to Caesarea Maritima, which was the center of the Roman control of Palestine at that time. And he was in prison there for 2 years before they sent him on to Rome. Some people have thought maybe that he was there, and when he talks about Caesar's household, he simply means, you know, the royal the royal guards, the people who were part of the formal establishment. Others have said that maybe he was actually, he was in jail in Ephesus. We have no record of that. All of those are just theories. The strongest indication, reading it on its face value and without any other strong evidence otherwise, is that Paul was writing from Rome, and it was from there he wrote the church in Philippi in this letter, and then also to the church in Ephesus. This is long after he had been there, and then also to Colossae. All of those letters from jail in Rome. The theme of the book of Philippians is the Christ-centered life, the sign of which is joy. This has been called the epistle of joy. This is the most affectionate, the warmest. I think I've mentioned to you before that when I was a junior counselor at a Bible camp, when I was in high school, and in the off season, you know, during the winter time, the junior counselors would all write to each other, and with the enthusiasm of our youth, we would write scripture verses and Bible quotes and everything else on the outside of the envelopes, you know. And we would get those. You can always tell when you've gotten a letter from somebody from Bible camp because you can see the postmaster, the postman, standing out of the mailbox reading all this stuff. Well, there was no chapter that got quoted, or no book of the New Testament that got quoted more often in that context than Philippians, because it is full of joy, and it's full of warmth, and it's full of affection. It is clear that Paul, while he declares his affection for the church in Corinth and elsewhere, there was no church that he felt as warm toward, as strongly in his affection for, as the church in Philippi. Yes, Bob?
I was just interested, what would they write these letters on, and what would they write with, and how long would they last?
Most of the letters in that day would have been written on papyrus. Okay, either papyrus or vellum. Vellum is animal skin that would get scraped. The papyrus was the usual thing that they would use to make scrolls out of. And so most of this stuff, and papyrus is a reed. The Egyptians invented it, but it continued to be used for a long time. All of the most ancient documents that we have of Scripture, the Codex Sinaiticus, the Codex Vaticanus, and others, the oldest existing or extant copies of Scripture we have, are either written on papyrus or written on vellum. The thing about papyrus was it was fragile. It could, as it got older, it could get brittle. If it got damp, because it was organic, it was made from reeds, it could mold, you know, literally could rot. And so it was very fragile. The Dead Sea Scrolls, almost all of the Dead Sea Scrolls, were written on papyrus. Well, if you've ever seen photographs of the Dead Sea Scrolls, you see that most of them are just bits and pieces that they've had to sort of lay out and figure out because parts of it have decayed, have fallen apart and disappeared, turned into dust. So, but papyrus was the most common because it was the cheapest and the easiest to transport. Vellum was animal skins. The very best of it is lambskin that they would scrape and tan. If you've ever been in a museum and you've seen some of the old, like even medieval books that have these really thick, sort of, you know, stiff pages, that's vellum, that's animal skin. The problem was it was expensive. Even if you did it really well, like lambskin is thinner, but even if you did it well, it was fairly thick. So it meant, and it was heavier, much heavier than papyrus, which is much like paper today. And so it wasn't as compact. It was heavier, harder to transport if you're taking it somewhere, etc. A lot more expensive. You can only imagine. You know, the cost of an animal skin that has been treated and scraped, especially for this, would cost a lot more than something that's made out of reeds. So papyrus was the common thing. And that's why we don't have any extant, you know, any very, very, very early documents, is because it did decay.
Did they use ink?
Yeah, they used an ink. They used, they would have an inkwell, and what they usually used was a piece of reed that would be sharpened on the end. You know, they would cut it at an angle and use it sort of like a calligraphy pen. You all know calligraphy, right? Well, they would do the Hebrew letters for the Old Testament stuff, or if they were writing in Hebrew, or the Greek letters, any of them could be done very well. Those letters are easily done using a stylus. So they would call it a stylus.
So Paul would give these letters to a friend, and then the friend would take it to one of the churches to read.
Right.
But apparently, it might not last very long, so probably it'd have to be recopied many times, I would think.
Right, and that's why they had full-time people doing that, scribes. Right? There was a very important profession in those days were people who made copies of things. Now, the fact that it took time and therefore was expensive to make copies is exactly why they often would do circular letters, which means they would write a letter which was intended for multiple churches. The book of Revelation is like that. The first part of the book of Revelation has directions to seven different churches. In fact, if you look at this map, you see Laodicea has a cross, Philadelphia has a cross, Sardis, Thyatira, Pergamum, Smyrna, and Ephesus. Those are the seven churches of the book of Revelation. Now, in the book of Revelation, and this is just one example, John writes a section for each one of those. He writes something to the church of Laodicea, he writes something to the church in Thyatira, to Philadelphia, to Ephesus, etc. And the intention was, all of that was in one letter, and then the rest of the book is intended for everybody, and it would have been sent probably, rather than send out seven copies of it, they would send it, you know, it started in the church of Ephesus, which is the church of St. John. You can see the foundations and the tomb of John there, although it's just ruins, none of these churches still exist. And from there, they would take it, and Smyrna would read it, and then Pergamum would read it, and Thyatira would read it, and then Sardis would read it, and Philadelphia would read it, and Laodicea would read it. Now, there are places, in fact, in Colossians, I think it's in Colossians, forgive me if I'm wrong about that, Paul mentions the fact, make sure you read the letter that I sent to the Laodiceans, and when you're finished, send your letter to the Laodiceans. Well, we don't have Paul's letter to the Laodiceans. That's one of them, just like we don't have two of the four letters he wrote to Corinth, but we know that he wrote them because he refers to them. So, he tells the Colossians, read this, and then send it on to the Laodiceans so they can read it, and make sure you get a copy of the letter, you know, that you read the letter that I sent to the Laodiceans. So they would do these circular letters. They would go multiple places. We even think because the letter to the Ephesians, Paul spent more time in Ephesus than anywhere else, and so you would think that he would have more relations with the Ephesians and would write a letter that is more personal, that's more intimate, that talks more specifically about problems and needs. But in fact, the letter to the Ephesians is one of the most general letters, with the exception of the Romans. It's not specific. It's not addressing particular problems. And because of that, and because we have some fairly early versions of the letter of Ephesians, that is, old texts, that don't have to the church in Ephesus in there, we think that that may have been a circular letter. Paul intended it to be read by multiple churches, so he doesn't address specific problems so much. And some of the early copies we have happen to be the ones that they wrote in the church in Ephesus. But they may have made another copy in that case and written in the church in Laodicea, and the rest of it's all the same, or the church in Smyrna, or the church in Philadelphia, or Pergamum, etc. That's one reason why we believe as much as Paul knew and was related to the church in Ephesus, there's very little personal kind of information in that letter, okay? But they would share them, but when something was as important as Scripture, people would have copies of it made. And certainly people of wealth, now in those days, 1,000 books was a huge library. I mean, that was like, you got to be really wealthy and well-connected to collect 1,000 scrolls or 1,000 books. Nowadays, 1,000 books is just getting you going if you're in theology, all right? So it was not nearly the way we think about it. Usually there would be books that were shared amongst the church members because they'd have one handwritten copy that people would share, and sometimes they would also be shared with nearby churches. So very different, but they did have a way to copy them by hand. And they did invest in that, because by the end of, toward the end of the second century, and certainly throughout the third century, there was a clear understanding, and there were lists that were sent around saying, here are the books that God has ordained as part of our canon, our yardstick, our ruler. You know, these are the books we believe are inspired by God. And the fact that they have copies of those lists of which books were included meant there would have been commonality. The churches would have had access to those and would have known these are the books that we believe are from God. And it did not include the Gospel of Thomas or the Shepherd of Hermes or a lot of the other books that Elaine Pagels and other people say should be part of the New Testament. Okay? They've never been considered canon, part of the Bible, okay? Ever. And in fact, the Apocrypha was never considered part of the Bible until the mid-1500s in response against the Reformation. The Apocrypha was always seen as history books that were useful, informative, but not scripture, not until the Catholic Church decided that in the 16th century. Okay? So, that's a long answer to your question, but does that give you what you need?
Yeah.
Okay. The purpose of the book of Philippians is to thank the Philippians for their support. Even though the church in Philippi, apparently, like most young churches, was predominantly poor, it wasn't until they'd been there a while that they began to reach some people in the upper echelons. The church in Corinth had a couple of wealthy members, but even the church in Corinth, which was a very rich city, most of the members were lower, you know, lower income people. Many of them were slaves. Well, the same thing was true in Philippi, but Paul holds up the Philippians as being one of the few churches that were really outgoing and trying to support Paul, and also to give to support the church in Jerusalem, which Paul collected money for. In fact, in most cases, because they were so reluctant, like in Corinth, Paul actually makes a point in the letters to the Corinthians of saying, I didn't take anything from you. I never asked you for anything. In fact, to the Corinthians, he said, when I was there in your midst ministering to you, you didn't support me. I was being supported by the churches in Macedonia. The first church in Macedonia was Philippi. So they were paying for Paul's expenses, even when he was in some place like Corinth, which was a very wealthy town, and that Corinth could very well have cared for Paul's needs. But the Corinthians, for some reason, were reluctant. Even though God loves a cheerful giver, you know, he doesn't. Paul was not trying to extort anything out of them. But the church in Philippi, Paul actually recognizes their gifts, and he accepts their gifts because they were so generous toward him. And apparently, unlike some of the churches that began to have, you know, began to listen to people who were against Paul, like the church in Galatia, the church in Corinth, the Philippians really love Paul, and Paul returns that affection in this book. It's a very warm feeling. So he's thanking the Philippians for their support. He is reporting on his own circumstances, and then he's encouraging the church. Apparently, the church in Philippi had undergone some persecution, and he's encouraging them to humility and also warning against false teachers. There's not the indication that they had suffered from false teaching the way that the church in Galatia had. Seriously, a problem. The whole point of the letter to the Galatians is to teach them and warn them against the Judaizers, the false teachers who were telling them they had to be circumcised. And Colossians, which we'll get to here shortly, much of Colossians is dealing with false teaching, which looks to be a kind of proto-Gnosticism. Proto means first or early. Gnosticism, I'll talk about that in a minute, was a philosophical religious belief that really became a major factor in the Roman world in the second century. Well, we believe this was an early version of it, okay? You might think of it in terms of Paul starts out with his statement of affection to the Corinthians in terms of that line, and then he talks about his current circumstance. He's in jail. He's in prison. And there's an indication that he might not be released. Later on, he recognizes the fact in the letter that there's a chance I can be able to come to see you, and I want to send Timothy to you, and I hope that I can come and see you myself. So Paul's still not sure what his situation is going to be, but he promises if he can, he wants to come and see them again. He then makes the appeal that they have the mind of Christ, then the knowledge of Christ, then the peace of Christ. And we'll talk about that a little bit. Some of the key verses in Philippians, and again, I can quote all of Philippians. I mean, we could just stand here and read Philippians because it's only four chapters. Both Philippians and Colossians are only four chapters. Philemon's only one chapter. Very different kind of book, Philemon. But Philippians, in the four chapters, it's all really rich stuff. Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Paul says that in the midst of a meditation, which he's being clear. He's in prison, and this is the first chapter. He's telling him the circumstances, and he recognizes he might not survive. And he gives a little meditation in the first chapter of Philippians about how he feels about that. And he says, well, if I die, I can be with the Lord. But if I live, then I can be of benefit to you more and to other believers. And he's sort of weighing these options. And he says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain, but then he says, but I will live. In other words, as long as he has the choice, in order to be of ministry in the Lord's will, especially to help you and to help the other followers. So that's part of it. And then toward the end of the book, in chapter 4, he says, I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. Again, remember, he's in prison. And being in a Roman prison wasn't like being in a, you know, in a country club prison, you know, minimum security prison or even a maximum security prison. If you didn't have people who knew you and cared about you and brought you food and brought you blankets and brought you stuff, then you starved to death or you froze to death in a Roman prison. The Romans didn't do anything to take care of you if you were in prison. You had to have somebody else come and do it. Now, the belief is that the first time Paul was in prison in Rome, he was in a house. He was under house arrest. But still, he couldn't pop out and go to the local Super Lake. Somebody had to bring him things. And they did. They provided for his needs. Later on, we believe in the second arrest in Rome, the second imprisonment in Rome, and also the same thing with Peter, that he was put in the Mamertine prison. Any of you all been to Rome and seen the Mamertine prison? You know, what is it? Can you describe it? It's a hole. All right? You walk into this room, and there's a hole in the floor, and underneath, there is a giant, like, well that's dug out. That's the Mamertine prison. They would take a prisoner, drop them down in there, and, you know, unless they got, for some reason, the officials said, okay, you can turn them loose, they didn't come out of there again. And people had to bring food and bring skins of water and things, and, you know, it would be dropped down to them, and that's where he was in prison. So not a very pleasant environment. But the first time he was in a house church, but Paul still is talking about the circumstances he's in being very difficult. I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through Him who gives me strength. And this, of course, is the theme that he gets to. I mean, the joy in relationship, the encouragement he wants to give them, that it all comes back down to the presence of Christ in their lives, in his life and the life of the Philippian believers as being the focus of their satisfaction. Some of the major points in Philippians, again, this is the letter of joy and of encouragement. It's the most personal of his letters. He shows his fond affection for the Philippians, the people in Philippi. Paul shares his present circumstances in prison in Rome, one of the four prison epistles. Paul shares his appreciation for the consistent testimony and support from the Philippians. They had provided financially for him, but he also gets reports that they are continuing to share the gospel. They are faithful to the message, the gospel message, as Paul presented it, as opposed to the Galatians and the Corinthians and others who had wandered off of the message Paul gave them by listening to false teachers. There's no indication. While Paul encourages them to be careful, because there are false teachers out and about trying to teach wrong doctrine, there's no indication that we have that the Philippians really had fallen for that, the way the Galatians had and the Corinthians had. And then finally, he exhorts the Philippians to have unity, to have humility, to have the mind of Christ. The encouragement. Okay? Any questions about any of that? First John and then Bob.
You mentioned that Paul was in prison twice. Mm-hmm. Is that based on the idea or the tradition that he left prison and went to Spain? Mm-hmm. Or is that based in Scripture?
Because
you only see really one imprisonment.
One imprisonment in Rome. He was in prison elsewhere. You know, he was in prison in Philippi. He was in jail in Philippi. He was in prison for 2 years in Caesarea. So he spent other time in jail. But, the idea of this
only
being...
Only once in Rome.
Well, once... The book of Acts ends with his first imprisonment. But Paul expresses in Romans his desire to go to Spain and that I will come and visit you. And so we have a tradition that he did visit, you know, that he was in Rome. We have the strong traditions that he visited Spain, some tradition he visited Britain, and then came back again.
So it is speculated that in Philippians, his mention of imprisonment here was his final imprisonment.
No, it's believed that this was his first imprisonment in Rome.
In the house.
Yes. Okay. Correct. When I talk about the Mamertine prison, that would have been... The tradition is that that's when he was arrested later, and he was put in a much harsher environment within the house prison he was in the first time, okay, or the house imprisonment. Let's look at quickly at an outline of the book of Philippians. Again, Paul starts out with his present circumstance. He gives a prayer of thanksgiving for the Philippians. Oh, I'm sorry, Bob, I forgot to call on you. Yes.
Well, I just wanted to go back to Philippians 1:21.
Okay.
A second, and just wanted to share with you and some of the others that you may have experienced this also, but after I was in the hospital and I almost died, I really had a lot of mixed up feelings about that. Because on the one hand, as my friend said, I could have been sharing chicken fried steak with Jesus. But on the other hand, I could be here doing my work. So I was really mixed up for quite a while after that.
Yeah.
But that goes along with this verse here.
Yeah, very much so. And the appropriate, I mean, the response of Christian faith is that whichever God chooses for us, it will be fine. Barry McGuire, if you all know Barry McGuire, he was one of the very first contemporary Christian artists. Before he became a Christian, he was a popular folk rock artist. He did a song called Eve of Destruction, which was a big hit, in which he talks about three-day parties twice a week. I often quote that. But when he became a Christian, he said that he had a good friend who had been diagnosed with terminal cancer, and he was given like 3 months to live. Well, Barry McGuire was getting ready to leave the States to go to Australia, and he was going to be gone 6 months. And so he knew his friend probably was not going to be alive when he got back. And Barry McGuire confessed, he said, I did not know what to say to him. He said, I hadn't been a Christian very long, I didn't have a lot of maturity. Well, my friend called me, and we're on the phone talking, and it was clear to him that I was uncomfortable. And Barry McGuire said, and my friend said, Barry, you're really uncomfortable, aren't you? He said, yeah, I am. And he said, why? And he said, well, because you're going to die. And I don't know what to say. His friend said, well, you could congratulate me. And Barry McGuire said, what?
Yeah.
And his friend, who was a committed believer, he said, well, in 4 months, one of two things is going to happen. Either I'm going to be miraculously healed, or I'm going to be face-to-face with Jesus. As far as I'm concerned, I can't lose. That is the testimony of Christian faith. And that's what Paul is talking about. For me to live is Christ, miraculously healed, released, but to die is gain. There's no downside for a person of real faith. And that's a, you know, that's how we should see it. One way or the other, God's will be done, He will be glorified, and we will be blessed. John?
One more thing. When you look at Paul, it seems like, and a lot of people don't pick this up, there is this titanic clash in his emotions, mm-hmm. between being desiring to be with the Lord. And that's just not a quaint little thing to say. As he got older, I think the roots in this earth got a little bit more shallow, and the attraction to heaven became stronger.
Yeah.
But at the same time, he's aware of his responsibilities, and so there's this tearing apart, of which I think people who embrace Christ and walk for years with Christ begin to experience that. And that's right. The explanation for that, you know, for that chasm,
right.
between wanting to be here and wanting to be in heaven. It's not weird. It's not strange, you know. There is an attraction to heaven that begins to
exactly.
take over.
If you really believe in heaven, then you understand it to be a good thing. And you don't get there unless you die or the Lord comes back first. And so, yeah, there is a blessing there. And also, we have to realize when Paul's talking about, you know, dying, this is Paul who had been beaten any number of times, stoned, shipwrecked, arrested several times, in prison for multiple years on more than one occasion. He had gone through all of it, all right? Denied by his own people, one struggle after another, and physically, you know, the demands of this. Bitten by poisonous snakes. I mean, you name it. He'd been through it. And yet, he's in prison in Rome, thinking initially that he may not survive it. He may be executed. And he says, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Most Christians I know, if you told them, because you're a Christian, the Mexican authorities are going to come and arrest you. You'll only be in jail for a few days, but they're going to come and arrest you. You'd be running for the border. What's wrong with us? You know, we're spiritual wimps. The idea that anything is going to happen to us as a result of our Christian testimony makes most of us, you know, go to the airport, buy a ticket to anywhere where we don't feel like we're going to, you know, nobody's going to do anything to us. Paul is an example of somebody who took everything they had to give and kept going as long as he could, but knew that when the time came and he died, that he was in the presence of the Lord that he had served. You know, in fact, he celebrates the fact that he has been given the opportunity to suffer for the Lord. Okay. This is a blessing to him, to be able to experience suffering in the name of the Lord. I think we really need to turn our thinking around in terms of what we believe the requirements of being a Christian are. When we think that any kind of persecution, any kind of pressure, any kind of unpleasantness, certainly any kind of physical suffering, is somehow, can't do that! Really? What about all of the saints down through the years who celebrated that they were able to suffer in the name of their Lord? Not just accepted it or put up with it, but celebrated it. What's wrong with us? We're spoiled. That's what's wrong with us. Okay. So, Paul talks about his present circumstances. He talks about how his afflictions have actually promoted the gospel. More people have heard because of his sufferings. And his afflictions have exalted the Lord. His suffering has been a good thing in a number of different ways. And then Paul exhorts the Philippians that if they suffer, as they suffer, and they apparently were suffering some persecution, not as bad as some of the other churches, Thessalonica and others, but that he encourages them in their affliction. He then tells them to have the mind of Christ, to learn, to grow spiritually, and growing spiritually means to become more godly. We use that expression, to become more godly. What does that mean other than to become more like God, as he was represented in Jesus Christ? To have the mind of Christ, to be more in our thinking the way Jesus was. He talks about humility, exhorts them to humility, and he uses Christ's humility, his own humility. Okay, it is a truly humble person that can talk about his own humility and mean it. All right, most people say, "Well, one of the things I'm really proud of is my humility." I've told this story many times that Charles Spurgeon had a woman come to him and say, "Pastor Spurgeon, I haven't sinned in over a week." And he said, "Well, you must be very proud." And she said, "Yes, I am." Not realizing that pride is the mother of all sins. And so Paul can, however, talk about his own humility and mean it. And nobody challenges him on that. C.S. Lewis talked, Christ's example of humility. C.S. Lewis points out in Mere Christianity that Jesus said that he was humble and gentle of heart. And nobody seems to complain about the fact that if you look at the things Jesus said, the things he did, humble would not seem to be one of them. And yet, there is a consistency there. All right? His declarations of being the very Son of God and his humility were not inconsistent the way he lived his life. Well, Paul, claiming to be an apostle, the spiritual father of so many of these people, the founder of most of the churches, all of the churches at that point in the eastern part of Europe, and yet claiming to be humble. Nobody looks at that and goes, "No, you're not humble." He is. Humble does not mean to be self-defeated. It does not mean, "Oh, no, just this little me, it's I don't know." That's not it at all. That's not humility. Paul was bold and humble at the same time. And then Timothy's example of humility. He was with him at the time. And then Epaphroditus's example of humility. Epaphroditus was the one who had come from the Philippians to bring the Philippians gifts of support to Paul in Rome, and then administered to Paul, by his companionship, by his fellowship, and had brought to Paul information about what was going on with the Philippians, and then Paul is preparing to send Epaphroditus back to the church in Philippi as his messenger in return. And he speaks glowingly of Epaphroditus, of his ministry, of his commitment, of his own sacrifice. Apparently Epaphroditus had gotten very, very sick in Rome, to the point of death, and had recovered, but in the midst of all of his sickness and his near death and his recovery, he continued to be a very strong, committed believer. And so Paul honors him in that. So the mind of Christ, and humility being a major part of what it means, you'll notice that all five of these examples of the mind of Christ have to do with humility. Humility is the forgotten Christian virtue. All right. The reason that we probably can't perceive ourselves as ever experiencing any suffering is because we say, "Well, that couldn't happen to me." Pride. Then we have the knowledge of Christ, warning against confidence in the flesh, exhorting them to know Christ, and warning against living for the flesh. And again, Paul did not have strong indications that the Philippians were doing this, unlike the Corinthians, where he had open sexual immorality amongst members of the church and nobody was calling on it. But he's just encouraging them because these are some of the issues that especially Gentile Christians struggle with. And then finally, Paul appeals to them to have the peace of Christ. Peace amongst the brethren. He does mention that two of the women in the church, it appears, may have been having an argument because he encourages them to have unity between them. Then the peace of the Lord, peace in all circumstances, and then a conclusion. So very simple, very short, full of joy. The word joy appears, either joy or rejoicing, appears like 39 times in this letter. It is the joy of Christ, so a wonderful message. Any questions about any of that? All right, we still have the book of Colossians and the book of Philemon. Why don't we go ahead and take a break now? The book of Colossians. Again, same time period, by the Apostle Paul. Now, there are some people who question whether or not Colossians was written by Paul. It's one of the letters they question. But the reasons, just so you've got some sense of this, I think absolutely it was written by Paul, and most scholars believe it was. But the book of Colossians has about 43 words in it, in the vocabulary of Colossians, that don't appear anywhere else in Paul. That, plus the fact that the book of Colossians reflects a fairly high Christology. What we mean by that is a well-articulated, well-developed doctrine of Jesus as the Christ. That's what Christology is, the doctrine of Jesus as the Son of God who came to redeem us. Since Paul's letters are the earliest letters written in the New Testament, then some of Paul's, like Galatians, very hard-hitting, as we believe his first book, very hard-hitting with regard to the issue of circumcision, what it means to be a Christian, but not a highly developed Christology. The highest developed Christologies in the New Testament are written by John. For instance, the Gospel of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. That whole first chapter of John, as well as parts of the first epistle of John, are very high level, very sophisticated in terms of theological development, Christologies. Well, John wrote his letters much later than Paul did. In fact, the Gospel of John was written probably in the 80s or 90s, so we're talking 20 to 30 years after this book was written. In fact, more than 20 years after Paul's death. And so the idea was that the theological development of a Christology over time made for more sophisticated Christologies later. And some people look at the book of Colossians and say this has a fairly sophisticated Christology, and Paul couldn't have done that. Well, that's silly. Okay, Paul could have done that. And they say that it has 40-some words that don't appear anywhere else in Paul. Well, the book of Galatians has 35 words that don't appear anywhere else in Paul, and nobody questions that Galatians was written by Paul. Depending on what you're writing, you may use different words. Duh. And so, I don't think that there's any solid verification or anything really reliable to say that Paul did not write this. Now, another reason why they claim that Colossians might not have been written by Paul is the fact that he appears, not really specifically, but it appears that we know there's a heresy going on. There's some sort of false teaching that the church in Colossae have heard and apparently been giving into. And it appears from the way Paul describes it that it was a version of Gnosticism. Well, Gnosticism didn't get full-blown. It was not a real force in the Mediterranean world until the 2nd century, in the 100s. And of course, this was written, we believe, 61 to 63, so quite a long time before that. And I've said this before, too, I think. Some people say, we have no evidence of Gnosticism having existed before the 2nd century.
You do now.
And you go, well, what's that?
Yeah, you do now.
So, at the very least, scholars say that it appears that Paul is dealing with a sort of proto-Gnosticism, which means first Gnosticism or early Gnosticism. And one of the characteristics of Gnosticism was that it believed that the whole physical world was evil. Our physical body was evil. Everything was evil in the natural world. And in fact, that the natural world was produced by an evil spirit, not by a God who was good. And so everything in Colossians, Paul talks about the fact that people who deny the flesh, and he gives clear indication that this heresy they were listening to, in some ways, wanted to demean the human body. Well, the Christian faith and the Jewish faith is that God made the human body, and so therefore it can't be inherently wrong or inherently bad. This was one of the major problems. Well, Gnosticism also says that that there's no such thing as salvation, and so therefore no need for a savior. That if you want to be one of the in crowd, if you want to be one of the cool people, you know, one of the Gnostics, then what you need is secret knowledge. And that what Jesus was, he was a teacher of the secret knowledge, but he wasn't a savior. He was one of the enlightened ones that gave us the secret knowledge, sort of the secret handshake kind of deal. That's not Christianity. And so Paul opposes that here in Colossians. Again, that there's no strong argument that this couldn't have been written by Paul, because that didn't come along for another 50 to 100 years. Because Paul is addressing very specific elements that we believe was an early version of Gnosticism. Yes, Ron?
Was that the Colossian controversy?
Yes. Well, yeah, it was the issue that he's dealing with there. So, okay? So his purpose is to exalt Christ as completely adequate. You don't need secret knowledge. You don't need a secret handshake. You don't need what these other people were teaching. Christ is entirely sufficient, and the supremacy of Christ and then submission to Christ are the two halves of this book. Supremacy of Christ over all other things, this false philosophy you've been hearing, all of the secret knowledge, all of that kind of stuff, or any other religious belief, Christ is supreme over that. And once you recognize that, the second half of the book talks about how do you then live it? What does that mean in terms of submitting yourself to the truth of Jesus Christ? All right? It's interesting that Colossians and Ephesians have a lot of similarity, those two books. Almost as though they make the same points, but they come at it from opposite directions. The book of Ephesians talks about the idea that the church is the body of Christ. Colossians says Christ is the head of the church. They make the same point, but they come at it from opposite ends of the equation. Because, respective to the different situations they were facing, that emphasis was more appropriate to them. Give you a couple of key verses from Colossians. Colossians 2, 9 and 10. And again, he's talking about the supremacy of Christ. And so he talks about the clear divinity of Christ. Anybody who ever says that Jesus never claimed to be divine, or that, you know, that the New Testament doesn't claim he's divine, Colossians 2, 9 and 10. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. You don't need anything else. The very essence of God, the deity, lived in bodily form in Jesus Christ. And in him, you have been given everything you need, because he is the head over every other authority. There is no philosophy that trumps him. No anything that trumps him. And secondly, Colossians 3, 1 and 2, since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Now you'll notice, the first part, chapter 2, is identifying the supremacy of Christ. The second part, which comes in the chapter 3, because chapter 3 and 4 deals with, here's how you're supposed to live then. So don't get messed up in the earthly things. Recognize the supremacy of Christ in your own lives and how you live that out. Okay. Main points in the book of Colossians. Again, the Christ-centeredness. This is perhaps the most Christ-centered book in all of the Bible, which would mean all the New Testament, since Jesus didn't come before that. And in this book, Paul stresses the preeminence and sufficiency of Christ in all things. You don't need anything else. You don't need the secret handshake, special knowledge, or anything else. You don't need to practice asceticism, a denial of the body, like these proto-Gnostic heretics were telling the people in Colossae. Secondly, the sufficiency and supremacy of Christ calls for submission of all believers to Christ as Lord. And that in submitting ourselves to Christ as Lord, we actually are given freedom. One of the paradoxes. If you want to be free, you submit yourself to the authority of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And then you're made free. Thirdly, Paul explores how the union of believers with Jesus is the foundation upon which our whole earthly life should be built. Everything should be oriented around that. And this is a lesson that Christians today, in the Western world especially, really need to figure out. Our faith in Christ is not something we practice for an hour on Sunday morning, and then maybe if we go to Wednesday night Bible study. Paul is saying to the Colossians, everything in your life needs to be keyed to and connected to and feed off of your relationship with Jesus. Everything. Nothing is accepted. And finally, being in Christ means that we are dead to sin and alive in Him alone. Your very lives, in any way that matters, are dependent upon the presence of Christ in your life. Okay? So let's look at a quick outline. Again, this is in two parts. The first two chapters are part one, the supremacy of Christ in the church. In the introduction, Paul gives his greeting to the Colossians. Again, remember, he's never been there. He does have the church in Colossae apparently was planted by Epaphras, different guy than Epaphroditus from the Philippians letter. But Paul knew Epaphras. Epaphras apparently is with him then. And so there have been a lot of connections between them. It's possible, although we have no record of it, that Paul may have visited Colossae when he was in Ephesus or spent time in that part of Asia Minor, but we don't have that. It's not mentioned in the book of Acts that he did. We say that because there's also an indication from things Paul wrote that he may have made an extra trip to the Corinthians, the church in Corinth, that we don't know about. So for the 2.5 years that he was in Ephesus, he may have made some other side trips that didn't get recorded. That's possible. But other than that, we're not aware of any direct connection, any direct visits that Paul made to Colossae, but we do know that he was very close to the people that were Epaphras who planted the church and others who had visited there. So he gave his thanksgiving for the faith of the Colossians, his prayer for the Colossians, that's the introduction. And then we have, again, the preeminence of Christ. Christ is preeminent in all creations. In all creation, Christ is preeminent in redemption. He's the one that saved you. He's the one that made the world. John 1 again. In him, everything was made through him. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Paul reflects the same thing here. He is preeminent in redemption. You don't get saved any way other than through Jesus. And he is preeminent in the church. The church is the very body of Christ on earth. So, if you're part of creation, if you've been redeemed, if you're a member of the church, then you are part of Jesus. He is preeminent in all those aspects, not some other philosophy or knowledge. Then he talks in that context of freedom in Christ. Again, this paradox that you submit yourself to the lordship of Jesus and you are made free. You're made free from enticing words, from vain philosophy, from the judgment of men. Apparently these Gnostic philosophers, proto-Gnostic philosophers, were saying, well, that's really stupid that you believe that. Here's what you ought to believe. From improper worship and from the doctrines of men. You get in all of those this sense that they were being taught something wrong, and Paul is making them clear that they're free from having to listen to all that stuff. They're under, they have no obligations to anything other than Jesus. So that's part one, the supremacy of Christ in the church. Part two is what we then do with that. The submission to Christ in the church. First, he talks about the position of the believer, that we are in Christ. Then he talks about the practice of the believer, that we are to put off the old man, stop being what we were, put on the new man, we are made a new creature in Christ. And then he gives personal commands for holiness. We are to be a holy people, because we serve a holy Lord. And then he has a conclusion, he commends Tychicus, he sends greetings from his friends who were with him, and then has various introductions regarding this letter. Again, introducing people, who's delivering it and all that kind of stuff. So very simple. First half, Christ is supreme. Second half, because he's supreme, you are to submit to him, and everything in your life needs to be linked to the reality of Christ in your lives. Any questions about that? the most Christ-centered book in the New Testament, which means in the Bible. Okay? Let's spend a few minutes talking about the shortest of Paul's letters, which is the book of Philemon. The book of Philemon is one chapter, which means when you see it referred to, they'll say Philemon 24, because there's no chapters. Okay? It's all just the verses. Same time period, 60 to 63, this is the fourth of the prison letters, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. The theme is fellowship in Christ as being superior to cultural or social status, as in between a slave and a slave owner. The purpose is to encourage Philemon, who is being written to, the letter is to Philemon, which is why it's called that, to encourage Philemon to receive back a runaway slave, Onesimus, who is a Christian brother, as a service and personal favor to Paul. So, the setting here. Onesimus is mentioned earlier in the Colossian letter, for instance, as somebody who is a believer because of the ministry of Paul. He apparently has traveled to Rome and has visited along with Epaphras and others, as well as Epaphroditus from the Philippian church. And Paul is sending Epaphras, who had planted the church in Corinth, and Onesimus, both of whom had worked with Paul, back to Colossae. Onesimus apparently was a slave who, before he became a Christian, had stolen from his master, Philemon, and then had run away. In the Roman Empire, the penalty for being a runaway slave was death. In fact, if Onesimus had walked up to Philemon, his former master, on the street having run away, Philemon could have killed him right there and there would have been no penalty against him. That's how harsh they were. And the reason for that is, in most of the cities in the Roman Empire, there were more slaves than there were free people. And if the slaves were not absolutely kept under control, then the danger was that they would rise up and it would be a very horrible situation. You guys saw the Kirk Douglas movie Spartacus, right? Mm-hmm. Well, Spartacus is the movie, and it's based upon a real historical event, was an uprising of slaves, starting with slaves who were gladiators. But it was an uprising of slaves that threatened to destroy the Roman Empire. Well, what happened was when they finally got all, you know, captured Spartacus, when they captured the leaders, when they defeated the slave army, and there really was an army, they ended up crucifying hundreds and hundreds of these slaves on crosses all along the major road leading back into Rome. Why did they do that? Because they wanted to very clearly say, this is what happens to slaves who rebel. Well, the same principle was, an owner could kill a slave who had run away if they were recaptured as a sign to all the other slaves, you better not try this. Well, the issue though is, Philemon, the slave owner, had become a Christian in Colossae. Onesimus, the slave who ran away after having stolen, had become a Christian under Paul's ministry. And so Paul writes this letter back to Philemon, and he first gives thanks for Philemon and for his faith and for his, you know, his goodness as a person. He then asks him to take back Onesimus, and he says, I would rather keep Onesimus with me because he's such a help to me. You know, he's like a son to me, he says. But I'm sending him back to you. And then he encourages Onesimus to take him back as a Christian brother and not punish him. And Paul even then goes on to say, he promises Philemon that if he owed you anything, or if there was any other problem, credit that to my account. In other words, I'll pay you. So Paul is using his influence as a Christian leader to encourage this slave owner to take back his runaway slave rather than have him punished. Now, it was quite common, as I said earlier, for slaves to become Christians. Early, and amongst the Gentiles at least, early on, the earliest converts were probably slaves and the very poor. Later on, we have examples. Gaius in Corinth and others who became Christians who were leaders in the community, but not many of them. Mostly it was the poor and slaves, etc. So it was to be expected that there would be slaves who were Christians, and from time to time slave owners who were Christians. The issue of how do those people relate to each other? we need to understand that while it had, it also had its very dark, its very harsh side, slavery in the Roman world tended to be much less cruel, in most cases, tended to be, than what we think of as slavery like in the United States prior to the Civil War. Quite often, slaves in the Roman household were considered like members of the family. It was common, slaves were the ones who educated the children and took care of them and were guardians over them. It was not uncommon for a slave who was indentured or enslaved for a period of time. You know, they could have they could sell themselves into slavery for a period of time in order to be able to pay off a debt, for instance. At the end of that time, this wasn't true in all cases, but at the end of that time, they could be free to go. It was quite common for the slaves who began to feel like they were a member of the family to say, no, I don't want to be free. I want to continue to be part of this family. I'll continue to be your slave, because they were well cared for. And in fact, the instruction was given that when somebody decided they wanted to continue as a slave, they were to go up to, you know, sounds like a terrible thing to do, but they would go up to a door frame and have an awl driven through their earlobe, and that pierced earlobe would be a sign that they had the opportunity to be free, but they chose to continue to be a slave to their family. So that was not uncommon. Here Paul is saying, whatever the relationships are, the slave owner, the dominant relationship, the one that trumps everything else, the one that we need to focus on, is our relationship as brothers in Christ. That even between a slave owner and a slave, if you are both Christians, you can share together as brothers in Christ, even though one of you is clearly in charge. Not unlike an employer and an employee who are Christians. If they're both Christians, they should have the kind of relationship with one another that shows respect for each other, even though one of them is clearly in charge and the other is subordinate. That's what Paul is communicating. He's saying, don't do the thing you have a legal right to do. Take our brother Onesimus back. Forgive him. If he owes you something, if there's some other debt to be paid because of this, tell me and I will pay it. So Paul is being very gracious in that regard. This gives you an indication of the tone, Philemon 12 to 19, verses 12 to 19. I am sending him, this is Onesimus, who is my very heart. You see the gentleness that Paul is reflecting here. Who is my very heart back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains for the gospel. He's in prison. A prison letter. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you would do would be spontaneous and not forced. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back for good, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. In other words, your relationship should be brother more so than owner and slave. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. Paul is putting his reputation on the line here in terms of treat him the way you would treat me. And Paul was a person of great import to the Christians of that day, of course. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. So this is Paul's message. The themes of the book of Philemon are forgiveness, of equality between believers, even though he says here, don't take him back as a slave, but there's no indication he's really saying, give him his freedom. There's every reason to read this and say he's saying, take him back as a slave, but don't treat him like you're the master and he's the slave, even if he works for you and you're caring for him as a slave, treat him as a brother. He's upending the whole social kind of understanding. And he talks about grace in this letter. So forgiveness, equality, grace are major themes in this very short little letter. We could say, again, as I said, this is the shortest of all Paul's letters. It shows a spirit of courtesy. He is very modest and courteous to Philemon. He doesn't challenge him. He doesn't chastise him. He doesn't say, you know, you shouldn't have slaves anyway. Neither Jesus nor Paul or any other religious leaders or writers in the New Testament tried to do away with slavery. It was too embedded. It was too much a part of the culture. What they did is they wanted to change relationships all the way around, including between slaves and slave owners. So change the relationship. Bring grace, bring forgiveness, bring mercy into it. Have equality as brothers, even if there's not social equality. This is why later on there could be congregations of Christians that included both slaves and wealthy people who would worship together. So there's a spirit of courtesy, of discretion, of loving concern, as along with that request for forgiveness for a brother who otherwise could have been treated very harshly. And Paul is asking Philemon, resident of Colossae, who apparently became a Christian, not directly under Paul's ministry unless they had met somewhere else, but under the ministry of people that Paul had converted, to forgive and take back Onesimus, runaway slave, who likewise had become a Christian under Paul's teaching. There's a prayer for thanksgiving, petition for Onesimus, and then the promise of Paul to Philemon to pay any debt that existed. Any questions about this? Yes, Pam?
Do we know the outcome?
We don't. Well, there's no follow-up. We're not sure what happened. I would think that for a Christian, as Philemon was, to have not responded as Paul requested would have had some pretty serious consequences in terms of a relationship with other Christians. Because Paul was the spiritual father for a lot of these people. And in Asia Minor, you know, you had other Christian leaders, but at this time, before John became as dominant as the elder and leader over the next 30 years or so in that part of Asia Minor, Paul was the man and was seen as the representative of Christ more over and above anyone else. To have said, I don't care what Paul thinks, I'm not going to do that, would have been pretty hard to do in light of the fact that Paul was so respected and had so much influence over people. Marvin?
Well, as you said, if he owes you anything, charge it to me, not to mention that you owe everything to me.
Exactly.
I mean, it's very subtle. Hard to catch, but it's there.
It is.
The other thing is Philemon is going to have some kind of an interesting testimony as a Christian to other slaves and other people back then. Mm-hmm. You know, when I became a Christian, these wonderful things happened to me.
Right.
You know, and I think it would be an encouragement to others to take a look at Christianity as a way of life better than what they're...
Exactly. Whatever their circumstance were then.
Well, one of the things that really stands out to me is that despite the social differences, social classes, in Christ, we don't have the luxury to treat one another according to our social castes.
Yeah.
There's a different law there, and that's what really speaks to me.
And yet we do.
Yeah. That's why we need this book.
Exactly. No, that's why it's in here.
Yeah.
We do have very clear, I mean, let's face it, you go to a wealthy church,
exactly.
And there are a lot of wealthy churches, and you wear old blue jeans that are just beginning to get good, you know, they're just really comfortable. People are not going to even talk to you. There's the great story, and I'm talking particularly churches in Dallas. Okay, have you ever been to church in Dallas?
Yeah.
I mean, there are people in $3,000 suits and wearing jewels and the whole, and I'm thinking, where are we? And I don't believe in sloughing off too much. I'm uncomfortable when men wear hats in church, you know, things like that, simply because there's a respect issue. And so I'm not saying that it's all fair game. But there's a great story about a wealthy church, and this young man came in, and he was wearing sandals, and he was wearing, you know, torn jeans and everything else. And it was a really full church, and he didn't see a seat. So he walks down the aisle, and he sits down right in front of the pulpit. Well, one of the ushers, who is an older man who walks with a cane, some of you have heard this story, he starts down the aisle, and everybody's thinking, okay, he's going to make a move. He's going to tell him what for. He's going to make him get up. And the old, you know, the usher, who'd been part of the church for many, many years, he sort of walks down there with his cane, and very carefully, he lowers himself down and sits next to the guy on the floor. Now, which response was right? You know, the people who thought, make a move, what's wrong with that guy? Or the old usher who, despite the difficulty of getting down on the floor, went down and sat down next to him to make him comfortable. Okay. We have these social expectations. There's a great, I heard, Jack, you know Jack Hayford? Part of Foursquare Church. Jack Hayford was spoke a number of times at the chapel at World Vision when I was there. He told a story on himself. And I heard him tell the story. It wasn't somebody else. He said that on a particular day, he had been at church in the office, and he said everything went wrong that day. Everybody was complaining. Everybody's chewing on me about stuff. It was just a horrible day. And he said, I come home, and I walk in my den, and without thinking about it, I flip on the TV, and it's on Channel 40, which in Southern California, Channel 40 is the Trinity Broadcasting Network. Jan and Paul Crouch. If you don't know who Jan and Paul Crouch is, Jan Crouch is Tammy Faye Baker with bigger hair. Okay. Giant, you know, white wigs and all this makeup and the whole thing. Well, Jack Hayford said, I flipped the TV on and Jan and Paul Crouch was on there, and I looked at Jan Crouch and I thought, why would anybody want to look like that? And he said, Jack Hayford, I'll never forget, he said, I don't often claim to hear the voice of God. But in that instance, as clearly as I ever have, I heard God say to me, you don't like the way I made her, do you? And Jack Hayford said, I fell on my face in my study, and I literally wept before the Lord for my pride. How often do we say, I don't like the way God made that person, without realizing that's what we're saying? Jack Hayford had it right. Okay. And, you know, Paul is saying all the social standards, the way you dress, your makeup, whether or not you're a slave or a slave owner, none of that matters anymore. We are equal in Christ. Do we act like that? I mean, there are reasons why I don't wear a jacket and tie when I preach. Well, the biggest reason is because I hate that stuff. I wore that for 6 days a week for so many years. But that's not appropriate to our environment. I actually considered at one point when, you know, wearing robes, and I thought, no, that's even worse. All right? It sets a barrier, a distinction. And so part of what I, and I'm not putting this on anybody else, but part of what I see as my task is to make people feel welcome. And that means I don't want to get up there and not be like everybody else. And how many other people have you ever seen wear a tie down here? Okay. They just don't do it. I don't want them to feel like there's some barrier of any kind between me and them or between any of our believers and others. We've even had, you know, we had serious questions for a long time about, we wear name tags, and I always wear a name tag. I think everybody gets pretty quickly, they get the idea of who I am, even if they're new in the church, because my name's in the bulletin and all. But I still wear a name tag because I want them to wear a name tag, and I'm no better than they are. And I don't want to have a difference. We talked for a long time about, do we want to have name tags that say elder or deacon on them? And we finally decided we were going to start doing that just like the last week or two. Not because we want people to feel that there's a barrier, there's a division, like there's a special class of people, but because if they've got questions or needs or concerns, they'll know who to ask because the name tag will say that. But we had real serious conversations about that we don't want there to be barriers. We are all equal in Christ. Some of us have certain responsibilities to fulfill, but you know, it's not how you dress, it's not how much makeup you have, or whether your hair is big, or whether you are slave or free. There is no longer slave or free. You know, junior, Greek, male, or female. Bob?
I don't wear my name tag in church because I'm too humble.
Yeah. You're afraid if they found out who you were, they'd be, oh, you're Bob Plinke. No. Ken?
The book, I think, In His Steps, the Christian classic, mm-hmm. If I remember right from reading, the man who wrote that, his name escapes me at this time, had gone to several different well-to-do churches dressed like a homeless, you know, man, and just looked at how he was treated through all of that experience,
right.
And then he came back and wrote that book.
Right. Well, there actually was a recent record, I'm not going to remember the name or the church, but it got quite a bit of coverage, a very large church, you know, large like 6,000 people in each service, multiple services on a Sunday, huge church. They had hired a new minister. Well, on a given Sunday morning, there was a guy who came in, and his clothes weren't particularly clean, and you know, his head and shaved that morning, and he was a little bit rough looking, and people made it clear that they weren't real keen on him being there. Well, they get into the service, you know, and after the opening worshiping time and everything, the head of their elder board comes up and says, ladies and gentlemen, this morning we're very pleased that we can introduce to you our new minister. And they called him up from the congregation, and it was that guy. And so you think people weren't feeling like crawling under their seats, the people who had not, you know, he would go around, he'd gone around and asked people questions, and they either wouldn't give him an answer, or they'd give him one-word answers and turn and walk away. And he very clearly made a point with those people. And so we're still like that. And that is why this letter was given to us, I think. Barbara?
I may have missed this, I'm sorry. But who took the letter to Philemon? And whoever it was, did Onesimus go with him at the time?
Yes. In fact, Paul says, I'm sending Onesimus back to you. And now, whether he walked in the first time or whether Epaphras, who had planted the church in Colossae, is the one who went back and probably carried the letter. And I don't know exactly how they did it, but if it had been me, I would have said, okay, here's the letter. Epaphras, I want you to go in and give this to Philemon. Again, it's not very long. Wait until he reads it, and then bring Onesimus in.
Okay.
It's sort of how I picture it. But Onesimus and Epaphras are both going back to Colossae. And Epaphras himself would have been a leader. I mean, he was the one who planted the church originally in Colossae.
The very last sentence in the book here says, did Philemon heed Paul's advice? Would this little epistle have survived if he had not?
Well,
that's the very last sentence in the
the commentary.
It might not have survived if Philemon had not taken his suggestion.
Yeah.
So it was just speculation.
Yeah, good. John?
I read another point of view on that Onesimus took his own letter and presented it to Paul, which was a tremendous step of confidence in a returning slave.
Yeah.
I had read that. Where
presented it to Paul or presented it to Philemon?
To Philemon.
Yeah, and that's possible. He was there, whether he's the one that walked in or not, because we do have record. Because Colossians is talking about this, these are written at the same time. Colossians, Philemon, and Philippians, probably in that order. But in Colossians, it refers to the fact that Onesimus is with him and Epaphras is with him. And so they're headed back to Colossae and communicating both the letter to the Colossians and also the letter to Philemon.
So was Philemon in Colossae?
Yes, Philemon was in Colossae. And so it's likely that Epaphras and Onesimus, who we're told were both with Paul, they both went back to Colossae, and they took Paul's letter to the Colossians, and they took the personal letter to Philemon about taking Onesimus back. Okay? Martin?
We have an office policy where sometimes we have to communicate things to people that they may not be particularly expecting or pleased about, to send a letter, an email, so that they have an opportunity to read it and think about it, and it's still there in front of them. And then when you talk, it's not a shock.
Yeah.
They have time to assimilate the information.
Yeah. One of the principles that I teach in fundraising relationships is invite yourself, meaning send a written communication and say, you know, I really like to talk to you about this. I'll be calling you sometime in the next 3 or 4 days so that they expect your call and they've got some idea what it's all going to be about. It's not going to be a shock to them, and they're not going to be, you know, surprised or whatever. So, yeah, that is a good policy. All right, we're done early. I'm going to give you guys a 20-minute vacation, so celebrate. Thank you, and I will see you next week, unless you are in tomorrow's systematics class.